Rev up your engine!
Brady Bucker, so Scotty, two strokes are coming back in F1. What do you think about it? Okay, modern technology has gone far. They can make two strokes that don't pollute like the old two strokes did. They can make a lot of different technology with computer-controlled fuel injectors, GDI injection. They can make them run so they don't pollute much. Now, in terms of racing, of course, it makes sense. A two-stroke engine, every other stroke is a power stroke. In a four-stroke engine, one out of four is a power stroke. The other three are waste strokes. So you get so much more power and energy out of a two-stroke engine. That's why they put them in racing. That's why when I was young, the big old two-stroke motorcycles were the bee's knees because they put out so much power. Because instead of every fourth stroke is power, every second one is power. So they have a lot more power for their weight and their size. And now with modern technology, I mean, the Formula One race cars, you know, it's not something you're driving on the street, but they're going to make them so they don't pollute like the old stinky two-stroke ones did when I was young. Scotty, why does my Escape go into reverse smoothly when first started, but pauses and jerks into reverse when it's warmed up? Well, I hate to be the one to break it to you, but the transmission on your Escape is going out. As they warm up, if they have a problem, it's pausing and jerking when you put it in reverse. It's just wearing internally. And on Ford, especially Escapes, realize it's almost always reverse. That's the first gear that starts to go out in the transmission. Just the way Ford transmissions are made. They often lose reverse gear first. Either baby it and don't park where you have to back up very often. Or think about getting rid of it and getting a better built vehicle that's going to last a bit longer. Because to put a transmission in one of those Escapes is going to cost you thousands and thousands of dollars to do correctly. Jay Fountain says, my Xterra bucks a lot at speeds of 55 unless I let the engine warm up. Any ideas? I change spark plugs, camshaft sensors. Thanks. When an engine's cold, it has to have the perfect amount of air and fuel to make it run right. Once it's warmed up, it can be off a little bit and it'll still go okay. That's a Nissan Xterra. Two things you want to do. One is, watch my video, make your car run better with a little spray cleaner. You can clean the MAF sensor and the throttle plate that opens and closes. Watch the video. Cost you $16 for the two cans of cleaner and it'll last for five or six cleaning. That might fix it. If not, you might want to have your fuel injectors pressure cleaned. As they age, they won't spray just right. Once the engine's warmed up, like I said, it doesn't have to spray perfectly and it can go okay. But when it's cold, no. And also, what the heck? It's probably older. Change the fuel filter. A clogged fuel filter can do that too. Now, Bo's Heuristic says, Scotty, what do you think about a Volvo 240? Man, those old 240s could run forever. I had a customer had 550,000 miles on one. Those were solid, well-built cars. And the 740s were too. They were a little bit more expensive, had a little bit bigger engine in it. But those 240s, man, they could run forever. Once Volvo stopped making those, the quality started going pfft. They started to go to all this front-wheel drive crap. It didn't work quite as well. Now the Chinese own Volvo. But those 240s, it's probably the highlight of Volvo. Those things could just run and run and run. And if you can find one that doesn't have 500,000 miles on it, they still could be a good knock-around car. SNX1881 says, Scotty, do you think a 2012 Sierra 5.3 with 150,000 miles is a good buy? Only if you're getting it dirt cheap. 150,000 miles, I wouldn't give more than $3,000 for that truck. Mechanic checks it and says engine and transmission is good, go right ahead. But generally, with 150,000 miles, the transmission's on its last legs, unless it's already been replaced. Now, if the guy has had it replaced with a rebuilt, remanufactured transmission, then it could be pretty good. But generally, the transmissions will start to wear out, then don't overpay. With that kind of mileage, it's not worth much. Josh Laporta says, Scotty, is it normal for my gasket around the transmission to be seeping oil? My mechanic says it's normal. As you use a sponge-type gasket, it'll always seep some. All right, if it's an old car and it's got one of those cork gaskets, they will seep a little bit. Here's the thing. If you park it and it's not dripping on the ground, who cares? And if it doesn't drip every once in a while, you don't care about a dirty driveway, who cares? But if it's actually leaving big puddles, yeah, you want to fix it. Any vehicle as it ages is going to seep oil. My 94 Celica's got 240,000 miles. Yeah, the oil gaskets have little bits of oil on them, but none of them ever reach to the ground. The driveway under it is still dry. Who cares? Be logical when it comes to machines. Don't expect perfection when something is really old. And if it's not dripping on the ground, Who cares? Gabriel Onassis says, Scotty, I have a vibration on my brake pedal. It does it at any speed, and I feel it even if the brakes aren't pressed. Rotors are not warped. If you're not even pressing the brakes, and your brake pedal is vibrating, have your tires and wheels checked to see if they're out of balance or bent, because that will do it. Now, the only other thing that can do it when you're not even touching the brakes is if you got a bad ABS module. When the ABS modules go bad, they can make your brake pedal vibrate even when you're not using the brakes, because the ABS system is working all the time. And if it breaks, it could be pulsating your brakes and make the pedal go even though you're not touching it. So it's got to be one of those things. Check the wheel balance and tires to see if they're bent, because when they start bouncing around, the brake pedal will go up and down a little bit too, because it's shaking the tires around. Billy G says, I got an old Toyota Corolla metal gas tank, and it's leaking a little around the seams. It costs a lot for a tank. What should I do? Well, you don't want to be dangerous and have fires, but here's one of the craziest things I found out when I was a kid and still works on metal gas tanks. Soap. You get a bar of old-fashioned soap and you rub it all around the seams, you might find out it'll stop leaking. And every once in a while, put some more soap around. Something about soap and metal and gasoline, it will seal tiny little leaks. Now, if it's rotten and it's coming through, it's dangerous. But if it's leaking just at the seams, get a bar of soap. If it works, put the bar of soap in the trunk every once in a while. Rub some soap around. It actually can work. I mean, if you want to do a more professional job, there are fiberglass gas tank sealing kits you can buy that you can do on the car. 3M makes a very good one. Clean it, put the fiberglass on it, and it's made so that it will seal it, and then the gasoline won't come out anymore. But soap actually works. It's the oddest thing. But it can seal gas tank leaks on the metal. Now, plastic ones, forget it. It's a different game, but they're all plastic now. But if it's an older car and it's got a metal gas tank, yeah, it will work. X-Rider 04 says, Scotty, what do you think of a Mazda Speed 3 with 20,000 miles? Bought one. How much would you pay for it? Well, you know, if it was a standard transmission, I'd even think about getting it. Now, I don't like the Mazda automatics. The new ones are better than the old ones, but still, they're a lot zippier with the standard transmission. I don't pay much for my cars, and I probably would never buy it because it's only got 20,000 miles, and somebody would probably want too much money for it. I generally buy cars with more mileage that are older because I can get a great deal, and if you stick to Toyotas and Lexuses and you buy one with 60,000 miles, it might go 360,000 miles, and if you pay one-tenth of what the new price was, great. You're never going to be able to pay that for a car with 20,000 miles. But they can be decent cars, especially if it's a late model one. Schmiegel says, Scotty, I was looking for an interesting, reliable first car. I was looking at 03 Buick Park Avenue 3.8 V6. You think it's a good buy for $2,700 with 123,000 miles? All right. It's a 18-year-old Buick. Now, no way would I pay $2,700, maybe $1,500. But the 3.8 was one of the best engines GM ever made. Now, their transmissions are a little bit weak, so you'd want to check the transmission out, have a pro like me check it out to make sure the transmission is working correctly. They can last a long time. I would not pay $2,700, though. It's got 123,000 miles, and it's 18 years old. Put on your thinking cap. It's not worth that much money. It just isn't. But it can be a decent car. Pay less, and it might last a while. If you live up north, check it for rust. If the frame's rust and stuff, don't buy it. But if that's okay, pay less. It could be a decent car. Sergio Lai says, Scotty, what's your opinion on a BMW M2 manual? All right. Everybody knows I'm not a real BMW fan, but the M series are great cars with the manual, but they all are extremely expensive to repair and maintain. Now, if you're getting one, check on the internet, check with some experts, see how collectible the one you want to look at is. If it's a very collectible one, what the heck? You buy it, keep insurance on it, make sure you get the right insurance too. Get insurance where you have a rider on it and somebody gives an estimate of the value and you have that on the insurance policy so that if it's worth, you know, $40,000 and it gets wrecked, they don't say, oh, it's an old car, here's $5,000. Do that. And then if you get tired of it, you can always sell it to somebody else because a lot of people like certain M series. So look into that before you buy it. Black Vapor 76 says, Scotty, I bought an 06 Toyota Matrix XR5 Speed, 141,000 miles. Runs great, but when it stops, the engine drops to 800 RPM like it's straightening and back to 1,000 with or without the AC on. Should I be concerned? Well, Toyotas never generally won't do that unless there's a problem. What you want to do is clean the throttle, clean the MAFS airflow sensor. You'll probably find that'll go away entirely. Also check for vacuum leaks. It's what? It's a 15-year-old car. Maybe a vacuum line has come off. It sucks air. It'll idle up and down. It's no big deal. But if you want it to run perfect, and those things can run perfect, check all that stuff. Because that will make it go. A dirty throttle, dirty map air sensor, a vacuum leak will make it go between 800 and 1,000 as it tries to compensate for the problem. So if you never want to miss another one of my new car repair videos, remember to ring that bell.